Hey friends, today I am super excited to give you a behind the scenes look at the fantasy world and my world building process for my serial series on Wings of Ash and Dust, of which, as many of you know, the first episode, Wings of Betrayal, is releasing in under 3 weeks. That is so crazy to think about, but I'm super excited and I hope you guys are too. And we're going to talk about a lot of fun stuff today because as a behind the scenes sneak peek, I thought it'd be really exciting to share the basics about my fairy world with my five unique fairy clans, how I went about world building it, basically the process from inspiration to implementing it into the story. I'll share some story snippets along the way to give you a little bit of an idea of how this all works out in the story. And then I'll also be answering some of your guys' questions that you sent me over on Instagram. And if you are live here and I see Dania and Athena and JJ and Jennifer and Mary and a bunch of others, thank you so much for being here live. I will definitely love to answer your questions as we go along or at the end of the stream, as always. And if you are a writer, I'll also tell you how you can grab a few world building resources that I have, like my free world building and series Bible templates. Plus, if you're doing Camp NaNoWriMo or if you're just a writer, let me know that in the comments right now, because I'm also want to let you guys know that I'll be hosting more of my super fun book themed writing sprints, where you get to join one of my five fairy clans from my book during the sprint and compete for points with other clan members just by working on your own writing project. So if this sounds super exciting to you, make sure you're subscribed and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of those, and because that's all going to start next week. But first, let me tell you guys a bit about my fairy world, which again is the setting for the 6 episodes in my series, starting with Wings of Betrayal. And then we'll talk more about my world building process after that and how this all came together. And again, I just want to say a quick hi to some of you who are live. And I just asked before we got started, what are you guys most excited about talking about? So I'm just going to pull up a couple of these that I saw. Dania wants to know the concept of the fantasy world. We're definitely going to talk about that. Athena wants to know, here eating breakfast before work. I'm excited to see what inspiration you chose. We'll definitely talk about inspiration. JJ says, I'm excited to hear about how you built your world. We're going to talk about all the things. Hi, Jennifer. Good afternoon. I feel like I haven't been able to watch one of these in a while, but I hope to at least be able to listen in the background. Yes, of course. And also, if you guys are watching on the replay and you want to skip ahead a little bit, I will put timestamps in here so that you can skip around to the different topics. But yes, and Allie's here. Hello, Allie. Yay. And we have some people doing Camp NaNoWriMo. Yay, JJ. Athena is excited for the writing sprints. It was a lot of fun to do them last time. Yeah, so I have done them in the past. They were super fun. But now we have even more context around the world and the fairies. And I think it's just going to be so cool. Hi, Leanne. So, okay, let's get into the fun details, shall we? And some of you I know too are patrons or ARC team members who have already started reading episode 1. Some of you have even already finished episode 1. So if that's the case, definitely let me know that in the comments too. You guys are awesome. And let's start off with the basics about the world itself and the fairy cultures. And then we'll get into magic systems and a little bit of technology we have in there too. And also government and how that plays a part. It'll be really cool. So, world and cultures. First of all, the name of my fairy world is called Faelyn. And I came up with this purely because Fae is sort of short for fairies and Lan is sort of comes from the word land. So we have Faelyn. And here's a very rough sketch, okay, of the world I made for myself when I started world building. And as you can see, it's not like a two-dimensional, like flatland kind of view. It has like the main world, and then it has under the mainland, we have underground tunnels, and then above the mainland, we have a sky city. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but this is one of the reasons why I've had a hard time committing to having like a map designer kind of do my map for the book. I would really love to do that. So if you guys have people that you know and trust or services or ways I can make it myself, I think I'm going to have to end up making like 3 different maps for the 3 different planes in the world. But that would definitely be really cool. Let me know if you'd like to see an actual map. But for now, this is what I've got. And it was definitely really helpful to sort of sketch this out myself, so I had some kind of visual while I was writing the book. Also, in Phelan, like I've said, I have 5 fairy clans who live in 5 different parts or provinces of the world. And they, as you can see in the sketch, are the mountains, and they kind of surround the whole perimeter of their world. And then we've got, they have a sea, they have forests, they have the underground tunnels, and then a city in the clouds. And at the center of Phelan is what's called the Sacred Vine. And it is in the center, and the Sky City kind of sits on top of it. And if you think of Jack and the Beanstalk, basically picture that, the beanstalk in that story. That's kind of what inspired me for the Sacred Vine. And how like the vines kind of all twist together and then come up at the top. And it's like a really thick, really wide kind of vine. And this element kind of becomes very important in the story because based on their culture, the vine is believed to be the source of where their world originated from and grew out of. And in episode 2, you find out a little bit more of that and the history of the world. Okay, but besides where the fairies live, each clan is best distinguished by 2 other basic things: their type of wings that they have and what they value most, which is what I've called their etho. So each clan has a different etho. And let's do a quick breakdown of each fairy clan. And at the end, when I get through all of them, I'd love to know which one you guys think you identify with most. And then I'm going to tell you how you can actually officially find out which clan you'd belong with after that. So some of you have already heard a little bit of this in the past, but I actually created like a little write-up for each of the clans. So I'm just going to kind of read that to you. And again, you guys, let me know which one you identify with most, but maybe you identify with the Gwyllians. They are the strongest and boldest of the fairy clans. They live in the mountains that surround the fairy world. They defend its borders from raiding giants and ferocious dragons with their own dragon-like wings and the flawless weapons that they diligently forge. They value strength of body and willpower so fiercely that they stomp out any sign of weakness, even the need for emotion or magic. But deep beneath their determination and ambitiousness are protective, loyal hearts just waiting to be fanned into flame. So as you can see here, as I get into them, each clan has like their strength, their etho, what they're really good at, and they also have a weakness. And I think I really wanted to make sure, yeah, that the clans are balanced and real and have real flaws as well, because there's gonna be a lot of conflict between them throughout the story. Then we have the sylphs, which are basically like the bookworms of the fairy world with their heads quite literally in the clouds, ruling all of Phelan from their sky city. With their majestic bird-like wings, skills with potions, and insatiable desire for knowledge, these fairies tend to be scribes, researchers, potions experts, and teachers. They also believe that they are the only clan wise enough to rule their world, and they are determined to prove it. Or maybe you identify with the nymphs, who are an alluring clan who can live both on land and in their home in the sea because of their fin-like wings and ability to shift into a mermaid form. Valuing beauty above all else, these fairies tend to be everything from performers, musicians, artists, designers, and more. And as the greatest entertainers and party throwers in all of Phelan, they're always looking for a reason to celebrate, drinking up life, dealing with the hangover, and going right back in for more. Then we've got the dryads. Dryads are best known as the peacemakers of the fairy world, valuing and cultivating the protection of life above all else. Living in the forest, they have butterfly-like wings and often have physical features that mimic the plants and creatures they care for. Some are even what I'm calling changelings. I'm kind of reinterpreting the term changeling for fairy lore. Some are even changelings that can shapeshift into an animal or plant. While many are beast tamers and healing medics, none should be underestimated. If you threaten their home or anyone they hold dear, you may not live to tell the tale. And then finally, we have the kobolds. Kobolds may be the most eccentric of the clans with their steampunk attire and bat-like wings, though they much prefer terms like quirky, innovative, and resourceful. Valuing creativity above all else, kobolds are single-handedly responsible for the advancement of the fairy world. Deep in their maze of underground tunnels, they mine the most powerful substance, pixie dust, for all of their miraculous inventions, like ships that can fly. never satisfied with the same old thing. The kobolds are always coming up with bigger and better, faster and stranger things. Huh. And I had a question from Lovis, who said, how does the terrain and environment affect each of these clans? And so hopefully these descriptions shed a little light and insight into that question, Lovis. Huh. Okay. But, oh, I forgot to add an image for this, but I do want to say with the fairies that some fairies don't quite fit in. Any fairies that are banished from their clan or leave by choice are called the vagrants, which basically means homeless. Like if you looked it up in the dictionary, it would say a person without a settled home or regular work who wanders from place to place. But some vagrants, however, end up banding together, working against the clans that rejected them. And this could be a group like the pirates, which is what my main character Quinn starts out as being in the series. And we have a lot of fun with that. So let me know which clan you identify with most. I'm going to pull up some of the comments here. And let's see. Ooh, there's a lot of them. Hold on. Let me just go back here. Athena says, I'll be reading this weekend. I read the first chapter and I'm so excited. Yay. Thank you, Athena. Read episode one and loved it. I can't wait for episode two and love the map. Thank you. It's definitely rough, but it's something. Athena says, have you ever seen the map for Dante's Inferno? Do that, just do layers. Oh, okay, I'm gonna have to look that up, thank you. Hi, Megan, let's see, Crystal. Hi, Crystal, so excited, I love those maps and the breakdown of the clans, thank you. JJ says, I wonder if your cover designer or Ingrid could help you draw it or use it in the final book when you put all the episodes together. That is, if nothing else, I would love the final book with all the episodes to have the map. So yes, that's definitely a goal of mine. Hi, Amanda. Yay, thank you. I love that you think they're beautiful. Your clans and the sprint team contests are so fun. Yes, Amanda, I love when you get to jump in there. Amanda's saying Team Kobold, love it. Allie says, I'm a sylph. JJ says, I took the quiz and I'm a sylph too. Donnie says, Gwillion, awesome. You guys are fabulous. Okay, so let's continue. And actually, one question that I got from Gabriella over on Instagram is, how did you come up with the names of the clans? And this is a really great question because I often forget to talk about this. But basically, I started out researching fairy lore. And first, I wanted to see if there were different terms for different kinds of fairies that already existed and if I could just kind of build off of that. And so I found at least five. There were actually a lot more, but I found five that I really liked. And I adapted and reinterpreted them to create my own versions of these fairies. So if you Google search sylph, Gwillion, dryad, whatever, you would find a certain version of that kind of fairy in lore. And then again, I've kind of changed it for myself. My fairies, just to clarify, all basically look human, but they have pointed ears and obviously wings. And in the designing the clans themselves, I actually started with doing mashups of fairies with other kinds of lore that I really enjoyed and myths and stuff like mermaids, dragons, shifters. Obviously, you can see kind of those kind of things. And then I also thought through where in the world they would live and what their cultures might be like and what their beliefs would be, because again, they are in conflict. And even though they're all fairies, they have these different perspectives and different ways of doing things. And I really wanted to show that in their cultures. So here's one of the big news that I want to share with you is if you want to find out more about the clans and even what clan you officially belong to, I now have an actual like personality quiz, fairy clan quiz. So you can find out that on my website. And I've linked that quiz down below in the description. And it's kind of like a Harry Potter Hogwarts house quiz that will sort you into your clan. I've done this because one of my long-term goals, and I don't know if any of you who are writers can identify with this, but one of my long-term goals is to build a strong fandom around my books to help readers relate to and get invested in the story and the world. And I've just seen that like books that blow up and like really have far reach and like have really passionate fans are ones that cultivate a fandom and have these like extra kind of things like quizzes. And I even created a Spotify playlist for my ARC team that they can listen to like a soundtrack as they listen to or as they read the book. So like I have a song for like each chapter that I might release to like my newsletter subscribers. But I thought that creating things like this quiz would just be so fun for fans. And I'm super pumped that it's actually a real thing because like I've had this idea to create it like since the conception of this story. So that was really cool. And so I have that link down below if you want to check it out and find out more. And also, once readers take the quiz, I thought it'd be really cool for them to have the chance to buy some merch that for their clan and root on their favorite competitor as they read, like with their clan merch. And if you wanted to check out all the fun items in the store, the link is down below for that too. And every purchase helps support this book and all the future books coming out in the series. So actually, if I pop you over to the actual merch store here, here is some of the items. And it was just super fun to kind of put these together. And I'll talk about the artist who helped me create the different, yeah, let me get back to here, create the different artwork because she's amazing. Arctic Paintbrush, you can find her on Instagram. With that handle, she did such a fabulous job. I love having them all on my merch. And I also wanted to add that as the book covers come out, I also plan to add some merch that has this awesome artwork as well by Hillary Barden at ReeBarden on Instagram. Because there's 5 more book covers coming out for the serial, and then we'll have one big one for the actual book. So that's gonna be a lot of fun. And I always just love to shout out my artists because they're amazing. So if you're in need of an artist, I would definitely check them out. I'm just going to check the comments real fast. We have a nymph from Mary. Yay, she took the quiz. But she also loves Cobalt. And that's where, you know, the vagrants we talked about before could also be like a hybrid. So you could be half nymph, half Cobalt. Crystal, absolutely fit into the Dryad clan. It's a good thing I am one. Perfect. And she's going to finish reading this weekend because Crystal is part of my ARC team. And hi, Anna. Love the serial. It's awesome, Brittany. Thank you so much. So I'm glad you guys are having fun. We're going to get into the magic and technology next. And then eventually we'll get into some of the world building process as well, because I know a lot of you are excited about that. But back to the fairy world, not only did I have to think about landscapes and cultures, but, and this, that was probably the most fun part, to be honest, to brainstorm and like think through. But, then I wanted to obviously have some kind of magic system because we are in fantasy and I love when a book has a magic system. They're definitely can be complicated and have a lot of opportunities for plot holes. But I think that it's been, totally worth it to kind of flesh this out and to have a lot of fun with it. And with magic, I also had a heart to have some steampunk kind of elements in this story. And with that, having some kind of technology. And so Janine from Instagram actually asked, because she knew that was an aspect in the story, how magic and technology were used together. And so I first started looking into fairy folklore again, but wanted to add, you know, some of these tech elements. And when I was looking into the lore, one thing that kept coming up again and again that I always love is pixie dust. And as you guys heard a little bit before, pixie dust is the greatest resource in this world used for not only magic, but also technological uses. And I thought it'd be really fun to read you guys a story snippet from episode 1 that sort of describes pixie dust pretty well. And this is all, the whole story is narrated from the perspective of my main character and pirate pixie Quinn. So as in her voice, we'll hear a little bit about pixie dust. Its alluring scent wafts into my nose, a sugary aroma of all things sweet and tempting, yet light as air itself. It's the pure stuff. Luna scoops up a handful of the powdered crystals and takes a deep whiff, her body starting to float without the use of her wings. Really pure. Luna would know. Mined in the dark depths of the cobalt tunnels, there's nothing like smoking a pipe of fresh dust as the rush and soothing calm takes over. Once the greatest source of trade, Phelan depends on it for fuel, medicines, incantations, and more. Growing rarer and more valuable by the day, clans fight over and hoard it as black market bidding shoots sky high. These days, acquiring any of it is a victory. Ooh. So before we get to government, pixie dust is used for many different things, as you can tell, but there is currently in the story, I'll just let you know, is a great pixie dust shortage, which is part of the conflicts that are also going on. Plus there's a fairy killing plague that has been spreading throughout the land. And that is affecting the conflicts in the story and the government and everything that's going on. Let's see, Anna's saying she's hooked. I'm so excited. And you guys are just saying that this is awesome. So thank you so much. So for government and conflicts, actually I had, forgive me if I'm pronouncing this wrong, from Instagram, TV Sicides, asked, how does the government run? So let's get into it. Currently, one of the clans rules the rest. And this is the Sylph clan that lives up in the clouds. Over time, though, they have monopolized power and abused it. And in the book, you'll kind of find out how they got into power in the first place. But yes, over time, they have monopolized and abused the power. And because of this, threats of uprising and civil war have begun. Each clan believes they are worthy of ruling. And if they could just rule with their way of thinking, with their ethos, they would be able to save their world from the pixie dust shortages and the plague and the conflicts and everything that's going on. So each one is sort of vying for control. And their last chance to avoid an all-out war is to send a representative from each clan to compete in an ancient competition called the Ethodyne. There's two different ways I've been pronouncing that, but with Etho, we're going to say Ethodyne, to decide once and for all which clan deserves to rule the rest. P.S. I've just heard my neighbor is doing some yard work. So if you hear that, so sorry. Hopefully it's not too loud. But about the Ethodyne, I wanted to share another little story snippet. And so here's Quinn's take on the competition and the current hierarchy and conflicts as she states in the story. My mind shoots to the competition every port has been buzzing about for weeks, an ancient event where the eldest heirs of every clan used to face off in a series of dangerous trials to see who could master all of the ethos, deciding which clan was fit to rule Phelan next. With clan tensions, rebellion, and threats of war on the rise, the high and mighty Sylph leader, the fairy queen of all Phelan herself, has done the unthinkable. She reluctantly agreed to resurrect the Ethodyne. Even more surprisingly, she also agreed with the clan's final demand: whichever heir wins, their clan will rule permanently. When I'd first heard the news, I'd laughed. I hate the Sylphs as much as the next fairy, but every clan has their faults. Being in my line of work, I see them all. None of them are fit to rule, and holding a pointless competition isn't going to change that. Well, Quinn will see about that. Oh, and she also adds this. I forgot I added this as well. She also says, besides, it's almost a pity that we might soon return to peace. These tumultuous times have been kind to the pirates. With every clan at each other's throats, it's been that much easier for crime to slip by unnoticed. Or at least there's always another clan to pin the blame on. So that's, let's see, we covered magic, we covered cultures, we covered technology, we covered government and conflicts. And now I'd love to tell you guys a little bit about the world building process. And you guys can let me know if you have any further questions about the world itself or the process as we go through it. But let's get into my process, which basically has four steps. First of all, I looked for inspiration. And besides the world ideas I already had, I also looked at books and movies and TV shows with fantasy worlds that I loved for inspiration. So I'll just name a few of them. I mean, for Lord of the Rings, I loved that there was this vast fantasy world and then they kind of had to travel to then complete the quest kind of deal. And I have a competition in my book, but I didn't want the competition to just stay in one part of the world. I wanted them to have to travel to the different parts in order to compete. So that's sort of where it went to. And Lord of the Rings was definitely like a big inspiration for that. Then books like Divergent, I loved, you know, and a bunch of different books have this, but I feel like Divergent was like the big one that was talking about factions and how, you know, the culture kind of separates either naturally or purposely into these different groups and having different ways of doing things. And so I really loved that. Obviously, it's also in, you know, Harry Potter and different things like that. So I love this idea of factions. And obviously, we get to the competition part with things like Hunger Games and the conflicts that are a part of that. And you can see a few other books and movies in my genre as well. And I saw another, let's see, comment here. Mary said, goosebumps, need to read this weekend. No more excuses or delays. Mary, thank you so much. I'm so glad that, that little snippet got you super excited. So I hope you enjoy reading because Mary is both a patron and on my ARC team. She's amazing. So, and then my step two was to research and do more brainstorming. And part of the research was researching fairy lore, which I've said before, came up or sort of drew things in like pixie dust, terms like a changeling, which again, I've reimagined. And then I have words like puck, and I created some as well that you'll get into there. And then I also brought up a picture of my Pinterest boards because this was super fun to be able to create a different board for each different clan in each different province and really draw like visual inspiration. And I've showed this a lot before, but you wouldn't get access to this one if you follow me on Pinterest because this is a private one. But I do have some public Pinterest boards for world building and for this story as well. But that was my step number two. And then step number three was organization and fleshing everything out. And I had a question from Allie asking, did you organize your world using your series Bible? Because she's heard me talk about that before. And yes, big yes, series Bible and also my world building templates that I put into my series Bible. And these I have versions for Word, versions for Scrivener, Google Docs, and that's all linked below. And there's a video here that kind of explains that. And then I have a few others about my series Bible. But these were super vital in getting my brain sort of wrapped around all of my ideas and organizing them. So if you need any help with that, I break down a lot of the things that I could think of that you might need in your world building list. And then in these templates, yeah, I started with a basic list of all my ideas, kind of organizing them a little bit and then flesh them out. And yeah, we have locations, cultures, key places. I also even listed like the five senses in each of the locations too, so that when I got to describing each part of the world, I'd have, you know, smell, touch, taste, all the different parts of it. And then this was all obviously plotting the world, but how about applying it into the story once I started writing? And Allie also asked another great question. Did you change it up as you wrote the story? And the overwhelming answer is yes. I actually started, and I'll show you guys a little bit. And let me pull this up here because I think you'll be able to see it better. So this I think I've shown once or twice before. This is my original notebook that I used in middle school when I was first kind of coming up with this idea about a book with different fairy types and a quest and different things. There wasn't a competition in this version, but this is what I used to plot out the starting point of what this story eventually became. So all the way back in middle school, this is where it started. But then when I started on my publishing, kind of serious publishing journey over 3 years ago, I started with a physical series Bible, and you can see it's kind of separated into different sections and different templates that I created for the different characters and cultures and locations, and things are falling out of it. But this, these templates are part of the series Bible templates that I have linked for you guys. Super helpful, super great starting place. But once I got it into the physical form, it was really hard to like, I was making like little notes here and there because things would eventually change. So what I ended up doing in the end is transferring to a digital series Bible, which I have templates for as well, and a system for doing that. And that's what I've sort of tried to track a lot of. I ended up moving it over to Scrivener eventually. And because I was also writing in Scrivener at the same time. And so I could like just very naturally go back and forth to different things and adjust different things as I went. And now that the book is done, like I think what I'm actually going to have to do is like go back to those templates, make copies of them. And then as I read the book, update any other additions that I made, because there is going to be, or I've planned a second series serial or second book to this whole book that will publish. And so I have this whole other aspect of the story that will come later that I need to be able to reference all of these things. So that is the plan. right now with that, but I just wanted to show you the different forms in which that have taken place. And then, like I said, I had to keep adjusting things as I went, specifically when it came down to my main character's character arc and the overall plot. So I'll just bring this back up here as I tell you guys a little bit about this. With this story, I definitely came up with the world and the big world conflict before getting clear about who my main character was and what she wanted. And for the record, I do not recommend this. It worked out in my favor because I worked really hard to make it work. But your character is the biggest reason your readers will get invested. Like, the world is cool and everything, but if they're not emotionally invested in the character and it doesn't jive, they're arc and journey doesn't jive with the world, it's not going to have as big of a punch. It's not going to connect with people as much. And not doing this, not starting off with my character, or at least waiting to like flesh out all the world stuff before, but waiting until I had my character fleshed out, it definitely created some plot holes as I was editing, and there needed to be different changes. But that being said, again, I worked really hard to develop Quinn, who I love so much. I hope you guys really love her too. And based on beta reader feedback and now my ARC team feedback, I'm starting to get some reviews on Goodreads, and you guys are just blowing my mind with such sweet reviews. So thank you. I feel like the end result is a great balance between compelling characters and vivid world building. And again, you guys can let me know, those of you that have started reading, in the comments, if you agree. But that has just been really rewarding to see that even though I came up with some issues as I was going along, that it's all making sense and it's all coming together and being really cool. So there was that. And then I just wanted to put in here, I've said this a couple times and I have no idea when this is actually going to come out because he's still working on it. But one of my brothers who read an earlier version of my book actually loved the world so much and loved the story so much and the characters that he started building a board game around the story. And this is another kind of fandom thing that if you have, you're writing fantasy and one of your goals is to have people be big fans of your book, this is just another thing that can be really cool to try to get people even more invested and have another level of engagement in your story. So I'm really excited for when he kind of gets that going, and I will definitely be letting you guys know. He does have an Instagram. It's called Defending Phelan. And he's been posting some little tidbits here and there. But yeah, it'll be really cool when that is out. So yeah, that is all I had planned to share. I do have a few other questions that came out on Instagram, and you guys can let me know, those of you that are live, if you have any other questions. But so definitely type those in. But while you guys are typing your questions, I just want to remind you that next week we're kicking off Fairy Clan Writing Sprints for Camp. I might have a couple of little short videos about the book leading up to release at the end of this month. But for the most part, I have some other things I need time planning, and I thought it'd be really fun to give you guys writing time while you join your fairy clans. And I also work on some last minute stuff before publishing, because yeah, I really want this to go well, and I still have a lot to do. So I thought that would be really fun. But I do have, like I said, little videos I want to put out, like a book trailer that I'm working on and different things like that. And make sure that you're subscribed or follow me on Instagram, because I'm going to be updating you guys when we're actually having those. And if you're really excited about this story, obviously you can always go pre-order Wings of Betrayal today. If you do, it will get delivered to your Kindle device or app. So some people have been saying, oh, I don't own a Kindle. If you own any kind of smartphone, you can download the Kindle app, and all your ebooks will live on your Kindle app, which I personally love. And it will automatically be delivered to you on release day, which is less than 2 weeks away. And when you do, you can also sign up to get 4 early chapters of the book as well. And I have a form down below that you just fill it out, show me that you've pre-ordered the book, and then I'll send you 4 early chapters. And just real quick before we get into questions, I always want to make sure I give a huge thank you to my YouTube members and my patrons for all your guys' continued support. Honestly, these books would not be possible without your guys' help. So again, thank you guys so, so much. And let's get into a couple questions and then we will wrap up. I'm just going to look in the comments to see if we have any early questions that I don't want to forget about. Yes, composition notebooks. Yes for middle school, totally. Actually, Allie just came out with a revision video, and you had a composition notebook in there as well. And I was like, yes, composition notebooks. Tessie says, I'm a little late, but hi, so glad to make it to the live stream. Yay, and it'll be available on replay in just a little bit. Kylie, so glad I made it here live. I'm loving the arc of Wings of a Tradle. Thank you, Kylie. Fellow Dryads. Lovis, that's no, totally fine. Super excited for this. Thank you. I did answer your question, Lovis, earlier in the stream. So, you can watch the replay for that. Thank you so much for submitting a question. Anna says, as of now in Goodreads, the place to leave reviews, I have the book pre-ordered and was going to rate then. I love the world building. Thank you. Yes. Goodreads is a great place to write reviews until it is published. Dashing off to follow Defending Phelan on Instagram. Yes, my brother will love that. And I've graduated onto the decomposition notebooks. I love it. Sweet. Well, there's a couple of questions that I'm just going to answer. One of them is from Katie, and she was actually asking what the process, she had a couple questions. One was what was the process of creating the fairy quiz? I'm going to save that one till the end. If you guys are interested, hang around for that. But she also asked, most challenging part of creating your world, and what was the easiest part? And I'll just say real quick, the easiest was the brainstorming. That was the most fun. That was the getting all the inspiration and being like, ooh, this clan could be this and they could live here and they could do that. But then the hardest part was making sure that everything made sense, that it was believable, that I didn't have any plot holes, that I didn't have any magic rule holes, and sort of fitting the magic and the locations and the politics and the character arcs and all of that, that it all, the world supported that and sort of fed into that. So that was definitely the hardest part, but probably the most rewarding. Again, Tessie is here, and you sent in an early question that said, what's the favorite and least favorite parts of the world based or from your character's perspective, which I really love that you asked it from your main character's perspective. So from Quinn's perspective, her favorite parts of the world, at least in the beginning, are the Silver Sea, which is what the name of the sea is in the book, sailing on that, and then the pirates and how the pirates have, you know, not just one clan involved, but all of the clans, and they sort of kind of disband from like what divides them and they all sort of come together. But her least favorite part of the world is how the clans can be really segregated and hypocritical. And she complains about this in the first book, but she's not willing to do anything about it, at least in the beginning. So there's a little hint there that some change is definitely going to happen for Quinn going forward. And hopefully, Tessie, I know you came here late, but I did talk a little bit about, or I shared some snippets earlier that I think will kind of flesh out this as well. Leanne asked an early question from Instagram too. She said, I'd love to hear more about the history of dragons and mystics. And I wanted to say the question, but I do have to say that if I said those kind of things now, it would definitely spoil things going forward. So I'm just going to encourage you guys to read the series, read the books, and maybe by the end of when the whole series is out, I can talk a little bit more about that, because there's definitely a lot of cool things with that, the history of both of those creatures. And then the mystics, I can't remember if I've mentioned it on the stream, but they are a subsect of the Gwyllians that have very different views and haven't been seen for a very long time. But yeah, you're just going to have to, you're going to have to read the book to find out a little bit more about that. And the last question I have here, and I'll check the chat before we leave for sure. But the last question I got early was from Katie again. What was the process of creating the fairy quiz? And honestly, this could take a whole video to kind of walk you guys through what that process was, because it did take multiple steps. I think it came out pretty cool. A lot of people are really loving it, so that makes me happy. But the short answer is that there's a website called quizterra.com, quiz, and then T-E-R-R-A.com, that enables you to create personality quizzes like this pretty easily. The harder part was actually figuring out what questions I wanted to ask and then the answers that would then correlate to the results of letting you know which clan you belong to. That was definitely like a kind of Tetris kind of thing, brainstorming. I sent some of the questions to my CP and my beta readers to see if they had any thoughts. And then eventually when I had that all situated, then in Quizterra, I had to then assign which answer sort of correlated to which character, which clan and all of that. So it took a little bit of time, But what was the last note I had here? And how to make sure, oh, and then I had to make sure no one could end up split evenly between two or more clans. So the trick to that, my husband was like, you need a prime number of questions. So I either needed 7 questions or 11 questions. He gave me some other prime numbers because I'm not good at math. But if I did that, then that meant that like you couldn't be split. Like I answered half the questions, you know, this way and half the questions the other way. And then, yeah, if you guys want to see more in-depth video about this, because I could show you like literally like the steps and the tools that I used, let me know and I could put that on the schedule. Let's see. Megan said, will you be making a video about how you made your clan's quiz? Oh, see, Megan, you're totally in the same vein as Katie. So I've had 2 people already request that. So I'm definitely writing it down. Leanne says, brainstorming is always the fun part. I totally agree. And she said, fairies, clans, pirates, and pixie dust, we think alike. Yes, we do, my friend. Yes, we do. So this was really fun, you guys. And that's pretty much all I have. I hope you guys enjoyed learning a little bit more about Faelyn, my fairy world, and the clans. I hope you take the quiz. If you want to let me know in the comments down below which clan you got placed in, or if you want to post it on Instagram, there's a cute little picture that comes up with your results and a little description of the clan, and you can screenshot that, post it on Instagram or somewhere, and tag me at author Brittany Wang. But yeah, this was so much fun. I'd be super excited to hear about some of your worlds if you want to put that in the comments as well. And you guys, we're practically 2 weeks away from this book being done and being out in your hands. So I'm really, really excited. And I hope you guys are too. So I'm just going to pull up my end screen here. And I'll just say thanks so much for watching. And we'll see you guys next week for those writing sprints. Happy Camp Nano. I hope you guys are doing well if you've been writing. And we will see you then. Bye.